I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. That Mitzi shared, I had this picture, Eddie, as you guys were singing, that declaration in us. It's interesting to think about the implications of saying, I believe in you, to the Father, right? Or to Jesus. In particular, I had this vision of an old, maybe a 90s movie or something, I don't know, but it was Robin Williams, and it was about Peter Pan as an adult.
Hook.
Has anybody seen Hook? Hook is the movie. Okay. So, if y'all have seen it, the story is somewhat, is funny, but Peter Pan grows up back in our world, and he forgets that he's Peter Pan, and he has a family, and he kind of becomes an obsessed workaholic. But then they have to travel back to England for Grandma Wendy's birthday or something like that. And so his kids are abducted by Captain Hook, and he travels to Neverland, but he's traveling to Neverland to fight Captain Hook to get his children back, but he still hasn't put it together. And this may be the weirdest thing ever, but this is just what I was thinking about during worship in that moment. Great, now you guys know how I think, or at least a portion of it. So there's a portion of that, I don't remember where it was in the movie, but there's a portion of that where the lost boys begin to say, you are the Pan. You are the Pan. You are Peter Pan. You are Peter Pan. And it's starting to well up, right? And he's starting to believe that that's who he is. And then eventually, even his son goes, you are. Okay, God is not in an identity crisis. I do not want to say that. He knows exactly who he is. But this is what I thought of. When Jesus was back at his hometown, the scripture specifically says that he could not do many miracles there because they didn't what? Believe. There's something about the declaration of faith that actually somehow God has chosen in his infinite power, he's chosen to limit himself. I don't believe he's actually any less powerful, but he's chosen to limit himself so that the declaration of his people's belief empowers him to work on their behalf. And so I was thinking of that as Mitzi got up and shared, and as we went and sang again the chorus, I believe in you. I believe in you, you're the God of miracles, right? Some of that is what is stirring in me, but some of that I believe is doing something in the atmosphere where God is actually, he's actually being unleashed somehow, right? An atmosphere of faith is being created and stirred up so that he comes and delights to do great things in the atmosphere of faith. Anyway, that's what my mind was thinking of. So as we, God, we just say that, we just declare, we believe in you. When our hearts struggle, we believe in you. When we're not certain that that's even possible, we believe in you. When we're up against a rock in a hard place, we say we believe in you. You're the God of miracles. When we're up against MS, or when we're up against cancer, or we're up against life-threatening prognoses, or when we're up against disease or broken bones, or when we're up against mental disorders and and imbalances within the brain, when we're up against all these things that seem impossible, we just declare, we believe in you. We believe in you for the Carr household, and we believe in you for the Brown household, and we believe in you for those that are in the hospital and for those that are hurting. We believe in you. We believe in you for those that are discouraged. We believe, we just declare, you're the God who works miracles. You're the God of miracles. And we want it to just stir up an atmosphere, God, where you're welcome to work, where you can just feel like, hey, we want you here. Be welcome, Father. Be welcome to do great things among us. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hebrews chapter 6. Hebrews chapter 6. So let us stop going over, this is verse 1. So let us stop going over the basic teachings about Christ again and again. Let us go on instead and become mature in our understanding. Surely we don't need to start again with the fundamental importance of repenting from evil deeds and placing our faith in God. You don't need further instruction about baptisms, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And so, God willing, we will move forward to further understanding. For it is impossible to bring back to repentance those who were once enlightened, those who have experienced the good things of heaven and shared in the Holy Spirit, who have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the power of the age to come, and who then turn away from God. It is impossible to bring such people back to repentance. For by rejecting the Son of God, they themselves are nailing him to the cross once again and holding him up to public shame. When the ground soaks up the falling rain and bears a good crop for the farmer, it has God's blessing. But if a field bears thorns and thistles, it is useless. The farmer will soon condemn that field and burn it. Dear friends, even though we are talking this way, we really don't believe it applies to you. We are confident that you are meant for better things, things that come with salvation. For God is not unjust. He will not forget how hard you have worked for him and how you have shown your love to him by caring for other believers, as you still do. Our great desire is that you will keep on loving others as long as life lasts, in order to make certain that what you hope for will come true. Then you will not become spiritually dull and indifferent. Instead, you will follow the example of those who are going to inherit God's promises because of their faith and endurance. This is the Word of God. I want to point out two words in that passage. Two words. The first word is other, and the second word is things. You'll find the word other in this passage. Keep on loving others. Our great desire is that you will keep on loving others as long as life lasts, in order to make certain that your hope will come true. Then you will not become spiritually dull and indifferent. Instead, you will follow the example of those who are going to inherit God's promises because of their faith and endurance. Keep on loving others. The second one is things. Dear friends, even though we are talking this way, we really don't believe it applies to you, for we are confident that you are meant for better things, things that come with salvation. I want to explore those two words real quickly with you guys. Jump over to Luke chapter 4. All right. This is Luke chapter 4. This passage, I've been reading in Hebrews, and it reminded me of this passage. This was a couple of weeks ago, and then I actually shared this word with Eddie and Ashley in church last Sunday. But I'm just going to give you a little bit of background. Luke 4, verse 14, it says this. This is just after Jesus has been tempted in the wilderness, so we're brand new in the ministry of Jesus. Then Jesus returned to Galilee, filled with the Holy Spirit's power, and reports about him spread quickly through the whole region. He taught regularly in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to the village of Nazareth, his boyhood home, he went as usual to the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read the scriptures. The scroll of Isaiah the prophet was handed to him, and he unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come." He rolled up the scroll, handed it back to the attendant, and sat down. All eyes in the synagogue looked at him intently. Then he began to speak to them, "The scripture you've just heard has been fulfilled this very day." All right, skip down here. Verse 31, still in Luke 4. Then Jesus went to Capernaum, a town in Galilee, and taught there in the synagogue every Sabbath day. There too, people were amazed at his teaching, for he spoke with authority. Once, when he was in the synagogue, a man possessed by a demon, evil spirit, cried out, shouting, "Go away! Why are you interfering with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus reprimanded him and said, "Be quiet, come out of the man," he ordered, and at that the demon threw the man to the floor as the crowd watched, and then it came out of him without further hurting him. Amazed, the people exclaimed, "What authority and power this man's word possesses! Even evil spirits obey him, and they flee at his command." The news about Jesus spread through every village in the entire region. After leaving the synagogue that day, Jesus went to Simon's home. We're at verse 38 now, Luke chapter 4. Jesus went to Simon's home, where he found Simon's mother-in-law very sick with a high fever. "Please heal her," everyone begged. Standing at her bedside, he rebuked the fever, and it left her, and she got up at once and prepared a meal for them. As the sun went down that evening, people throughout the village brought sick family members to Jesus. No matter what their diseases were, the touch of his hand healed every one. Many were possessed by demons, and the demons came out at his command, shouting, "You are the Son of God!" But because they knew he was the Messiah, he rebuked them and refused to let them speak. Verse 42. Early the next morning, Jesus went out to an isolated place. The crowd searched for him everywhere, and when they finally found him, they begged him not to leave them. But he replied, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God in the other towns too, because that is why I was sent." All right. I read all that to set the backdrop, okay? Because I believe it's important for us to understand the purpose statements of Jesus. He makes several, right? Preston, I'm thinking of at least one. "For this purpose was the Son of Man made manifest, to destroy the works of the adversary." But this too is a purpose statement of Christ. "But I must preach the gospel to the other towns as well." And if you listen carefully, you see our word, don't you? To the other towns. Remember, I said we were going to explore two words. Other things. Okay. So he says, "But I must preach the gospel to the other towns as well, for this purpose was I sent." Why is that important? I think it's important because you just got done reading the backdrop to the story. Jesus is healing the sick, casting out devils. He rebuked the fever on Simon's mother. She got healed. People are amazed. And what happens when this kind of thing begins to manifest, what happens when crazy God stuff happens, is it's human nature to want to camp there. All right? You see this, I believe it's a similar principle. You remember at the Transfiguration, Jesus is shown in all of his glory. And Moses and Elijah are there, and the disciples who are with Jesus go, "Oh my goodness, this is amazing, this is awesome, let us build some tents, tabernacles, shelters, let us build some places," all right? I think it's just natural human tendency that we, when we get into a zone with the Lord, we have a tendency to camp there. I don't think it's anything abnormal. I think it's literally just part of the human heart. Sometimes even for good things, right? I hear people all the time. Sometimes even for good things. That's all I mean. There can be a tendency to camp out, and I don't think it's necessarily bad. I just think it's human nature. But when When the crowd found Jesus the following morning in an isolated, desolate place, they said, "Where have you been? Come back with us." And Jesus said, "I must go to the other towns as well. For this reason I was sent." I just say that because in Hebrews chapter 6, it's really interesting what the author of Hebrews points out. He's saying, I want you to keep on loving others so that you won't what? Do you remember? The word is so that you won't become lazy. That's literally what the Greek means. So that you won't atrophy. So that you won't become spiritually indifferent. So the Hebrew writer makes a connection between an enduring faith that loves and pursues others and avoiding spiritual atrophy or sluggishness. I think the ESV may say sluggishness. That word just literally means spiritual atrophy or laziness. So he's giving us, or she or whoever wrote it, is giving us a connection. If you want to avoid spiritual laziness, keep on loving others. Don't forget to pursue others. And then Jesus gives us the example. I know it's been awesome. I know you have enjoyed the miracles. I know the presence has been powerful. But for this reason, I was sent to preach the good news to the other towns as well. It's really interesting. Francis Chan wrote this in his book, Letters to the Church, and I'm going to butcher it, but it goes something like this. It says, isn't it interesting how in today's Christian culture, we lift up and celebrate a certain kind of Christian who might say, Lord, help me not be distracted. I have been a Christian for X number of years. I have been at such and such church for X number of years. Francis Chan, of righteousness and baptisms, you don't need it, or you ought not need it anymore. In Hebrews chapter 5, he says, I've got many other things that I want to teach you about, but you're like infants, not even mature enough to eat real food, still drinking milk, all right? That's what I call spiritual atrophy. That is what we might liken to a third. Or with what their children, what the choices that they may have been. So, my point is this. The Hebrew writer makes the connection later on, a few verses down. If you want to avoid spiritual atrophy, keep on loving others. All right. I'm going to stop there. Jesus, help us. Eddie and Jake invited, I don't know if they invited, maybe I invited myself. Eddie and Jake let me know a few weeks ago that they were going to take a Tuesday morning and go fishing. Well, Tuesdays, Armando and I's church day. And when I say church day, I mean that in every aspect of the word, because I'm realizing that it's our day where we spur one another on to follow Jesus. We may or may not be in this building, because this building is just a building. Y'all are the church. So we're all there. I'm like, bro, we're all, it's fishing, all right? There is not much that Mondo and I like to do better than fishing, except for fishing for men. All right, so text, I'm looking on 360. We got this app where we can all see where we are at any point in time, which I think is awesome. So I can see right now, if I were to zoom out, it would look, my icon, Mitzi's icon, Eddie's icon, and everybody else I've got on there would all be superimposed right in this spot right now. So I look at it, I jump in the truck with Mondo, and I see that Jake and Eddie are way north Tulsa. They're fishing way out north. And I'm like, man, that's not going to work. We're not going to travel all the way out there. So I was like, we had a pond scoped out. We want to go try it. So Mondo and I drive to this pond. Man, we cast in, and it's like, wham, fish on. And I am taking pictures, sending them to these guys like, you've got to come. Unless you're catching bigger fish than we are or more, you got to be here. So they're like, we're on our way. You know, so they're traveling down. I'm looking on my screen. I can see the icons traveling from North Tulsa. So we're super excited. Well, Mondo and I are still at this point by ourselves. We're fishing off this little point. And I mean, this is in Tulsa. It's down on South Tulsa, Sheridan area. Can't give away more than that. That's our honey bowl. And so we're fishing. And all of a sudden, I mean, there's just forest surrounding this whole pond. I mean, it is pretty, there's like one place where you can kind of get to without risking poison ivy. And we're at that one place. All of a sudden, we see this guy walk up. And he's got a handful of peaches. So, I don't even know. So Mondo and I are just like, yo, what's up, bro? And he's like, hey, man, are you guys catching fish? We're like, yeah. And like, in fact, you know, by this point, Mondo has already caught a huge bass, huge for us, not huge for Jeff, but huge for us. He's a real fisherman. We're just wannabe fishermen. So we're like, I pull out my phone, I'm like, you gotta see this picture. You know, Mondo had brought in probably a couple pound bass. And so I'm showing, he's like 18, 17, 18. He's like, whoa. He's like, man, I didn't even know there were bass in this pond. He's like, man, I've always come here. And he's like, I live in this neighborhood. And so we get to talking with him, and his name's Nick. And he kind of like sticks around. So we're like, man, what's your story, Nick? So we start talking to him, and we're like, what's with the peaches? And he was like, man, I was just walking around the trail looking for something to feed my, I think he had an aquarium full of fish and stuff. And he was like, I was just looking for something to feed my turtles or my fish or something. And I saw these peaches on the ground. And I was just going to go feed them to my turtles or something. I don't even remember, but it was just the most random thing. So I was like, okay. So we're like, peach dude, you know? And so then Mondo gets talking to him, and they go off there. And then the next thing I know, he's like, hey, would you mind if I, you know, fished with y'all? We had a couple extra poles. And sure. So he grabs one of the extra poles. He starts fishing. Eddie and Jake show up. So now there's like five of us. So we're making introductions. Hey, this is Nick. Hey, guys. And it becomes real apparent. Like, hey, every one of us are friends from church. We all love Jesus. I'm like, hey, how do you feel about Jesus? You know, no, I'm not really a believer. My parents are, you know, we just never really spent any time in church. And so he goes on. So the morning kind of goes on. And pretty soon he's like, hey, so do you want to go to this other place that I like to fish? So I'll take you there. Sure. So we pack up our stuff and we run back to the neighborhood where we were parked. He brings his car over and he drives us to another pond. So we start fishing at this pond. By this time, I'm starting to wonder, God, what are you doing? So we fish there for 30 minutes or an hour, and the next thing you know, it's time for lunch. So I'm like, hey, Nick, you want to come to lunch with us? Yeah, I'm in. Awesome. That's what we do. So we go to lunch. We're eating at Taco Bueno, right, with this random dude. And I'm just sitting next to him, asking him questions about his family. Asking him, man, my parents just didn't make priority for church. And just kind of learning a little bit about his story, learning a little bit about his family life. And he's going to be a senior in Jinx this coming year. And so we're talking to him. And I mean, we're just literally doing life. Next thing we know, I'm exchanging numbers. I'm like, hey. And he's like, we were walking out of Taco Bueno. And he's like, you know, where do y'all go to church again? Like, he's kind of got this like look on his face like, I've never really been interested in going to church until now. But now that I've met y'all. I mean, he didn't say that, but you can just see that kind of working through his mind. Like, all of a sudden, how can I not lose contact with these random four guys that I just met when I was bringing peaches to my turtles, you know? Like, it's just driving nuts. But as Mondo and I are driving back from Taco Bueno, we just kind of look at each other and we're like, you know what? Fishing is awesome, but this is really awesome. All right. I tell that story for a purpose. I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I literally had this thought a couple of days ago, and I was like, I wonder if we're just going to read for 2 Corinthians chapter 3 through 6, because it's so good. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. So we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. At one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view, but how differently we know him now. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a whole new person. The old life is gone, and a new life has begun. And all of this is a gift from God, who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. Chapter 6, verse 1, continuing the thought. As God's partners, then, or fellow workers, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. All right. We're going to go on to things, but that is the last verse that I wanted to. We are therefore God's ambassadors. We are therefore his representatives, as if, the scripture says, Christ was making his appeal through Remington or Joel or Jake or Eddie. It's as if God was making his appeal. So there's this interesting dynamic that Christ came to satisfy every legal requirement of the law because of our sin, right? He came and fulfilled every legal requirement, every sacrifice, every jot and tittle of the law was fulfilled in Christ, so that this good news, the fact that God has reconciled, he has brought the rift that was torn between God and man, in a rift that was unable to be repaired, God has mended it through Christ, through giving up his own son. Scripture says that it pleased God to crush his own son, right? Preston and I were talking about that with James on Thursday night. All right, it pleased God to bridge the gap between us. But then, in the most interesting of ways, God then said, it'll be through us, through the church, that I will make this appeal to mankind. That's why this love of others is so important. Because God has given us this ministry of reconciliation. Right? And God has given us this task of reconciling people to him. He gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. I don't even understand why, but he chose it. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. That's our plea to the world. We, as his ambassadors, are the ones that get to make that appeal. The interesting thing that I've noticed, and this is the second word in that passage that the Hebrew writer is talking about when he says, but for you, we are hopeful of better things. Things that have to do with salvation, all right? This is where we're going. An ambassador represents what? He represents his own nation or country. An ambassador in those days would have represented his own kingdom. The interesting and problematic issue with being an ambassador is you, in the natural, don't have any issues with knowing what you represent or who you represent because you are what? You are from that nation. You are a citizen of that whole nation. You are in love, probably, I'm just guessing if you took the position, you're in love with that nation's ways and their culture and what they believe in and what they stand for. So you are anxious and excited to represent that nation's values in the other nation that you now reside as ambassador, all right? That is not rocket science. That's just how it works in this life. The question that I have for us is, what if we, as Christ's ambassadors, sometimes fail to understand the kingdom that we represent? I mean, I think it's definitely possible. I know I don't understand fully the kingdom of God. But it's possible to reduce it to a point in which the ambassador, when he is making an appeal to this other nation, it is possible that if we take out all of the things that differentiate our home culture from the culture that we're in, that our appeal loses power. Matt, would you cue up that podcast? We'll let you listen to about 4 minutes of a brother in New York City, who pastors a church in New York City that I'm just highly, highly blessed and encouraged by. I respect this man a lot. And I think he does a much better job of explaining this to me, but he is going to talk a little bit in this passage, or in this clip. He's going to tell a story, but he's wanting to draw an illustration of what it can look like sometimes when an ambassador forgets the distinguishing factors or some of the things that distinguish his culture from another culture. Go ahead, Matt.
The full story, the whole story of the Bible is about creation. God's goodness, it starts in Genesis 1, not Genesis 3. Then we deal with the issue of sin. Then we deal with God's redemption. Then we talk about our future. And fundamentalism chopped the beginning off and the end off because they weren't issues that were really being challenged. It was only sin and the cross and salvation and the cross of the doctrines. And so as a result, next slide, the questions that were traditionally asked about why are we here, what's gone wrong, what's going to fix things, and what is the whole gospel, were reduced to this question. You're a sinner, you need salvation, and the gospel gets really good when you're dead somewhere else. And so this is what the story became. But Bert Buster says this: narrative is our culture's currency. He who tells the best story wins. And so because we didn't have the whole story, this began to sort of be distorted a little bit. Pat, I'll give you an analogy. We have two teenagers in our house. And I've been happily married for 20 years, two teenagers in the house, and we would get this date night. Now, date night consisted of sending our kids to youth group and then scrambling to watch a movie before they came home. Kind of classy, I know. So, my wife, who is also loves to cook, you know, gourmet foods, and she loves the kitchen. And so I say, hey, look, darling, I'm going to put the movie on because we need to get started before the kids come home. So why don't you just come in and watch the movie? And she's like, you know what, I'm in the kitchen. I'm just making a few more little snacks. Why don't you start the movie? I can hear it from in here. And I'm like, are you sure? She's like, yeah, no, trust me, it's fine. So 15 minutes later, she comes in, proper snackage. I'm talking just like all the good stuff put in front of me. Tray goes down. 2 minutes later, she's like, hey, why are they fighting? Minute later, are they together or are they brother and sister? Like, I don't understand all the dynamics. And I would say, hey, darling, believe it or not, one of the things they do in Hollywood is they work very, very hard when they open a movie to create like the context and character development and the scene so that 15 minutes in, you understand exactly what's happening. And she's like, oh, stop it, and then just ask me questions through the film. Now, she's also a little bit of a neat freak, so before the kids are coming home, she's like, let me just turn up the snacks. I'm like, do you want a hand? She's like, no, you really love the movie, just see it. She'll go to the kitchen, she's like, I can hear it from here. So she'll pack all the snacks up. 2 o'clock in the morning, I am awoken with an elbow in my ribs. Whatever happened to that couple? Did they get together in the end or not? Like, I just missed that little bit. I said, darling, this is actually quite amazing. What they do in Hollywood is that the last 15 minutes of the movie, they actually tie up all that angst through the character development, and they close it with this beautiful climax that everyone can appreciate so that husbands get to sleep through the night. That's just like one of the things they do in Hollywood. Now, in essence, when you take the beginning and the ending of the Christian story, you are left asking questions, scrambling to figure out what's actually happening. And because we haven't told the whole Christian story, we have a generation that is like looking and trying to make sense of God and Jesus and culture and the world, but they're not quite sure how it all fits together. And the reason it's important to have the whole story, the beginning and the end, is because the middle parts, particularly the part about the fall, only speak to our brokenness, but not our purpose. And they only speak to our fallen condition, not our created condition. Which means when you start a dialogue with culture and all you tell them is what is wrong with them, not who they are and why they're born, you're going to end up having a story that loses cultural influence.
Meyer says will keep us from spiritual indifference, sluggishness, and atrophy. But understanding the fullness of the proclamation of the gospel is also important. Because I have fallen into that trap, I'm sure some of you may have as well, and it makes evangelism difficult. And here's what I mean by that. When an ambassador reduces the cultural differences from their nation to another nation to simply a matter of brokenness, both parties can totally relate, right? I'm broken, you're broken. But that's not the only distinguishing factor in the kingdom of God. There is purpose. And so when the Hebrew writer says, but I am confident of this, I am confident for you of better things, I want to suggest to you that the Hebrew writer is making this kind of suggestion. That there's more than just a connection between the ambassadors of the kingdom of heaven and the people of this world, that's the church and those that we are to love. There's more of a connection than just the fact that, Ronnie, you've been forgiven and I've been forgiven. There's actually an entirely different kingdom that we've been accepted into, with an entirely different set of cultural mores, an entirely different way of life. I had the thought this morning of two magnets, right? And when you put together two magnets and you orient them to where the poles are the same, what do? They repel. They repel each other. When we boil the Christian story down in our attempt to love others to just the fact that we are both broken, sometimes we are actually taking the power of flipping that magnet around. Right? And all I'm really doing, Mitzi said it this way the other day. She had this question. She was talking about an unbeliever, somebody dear to us that's also an incredible person, somebody we both love. And she said, sometimes I just ask the question, what's really the difference? That I don't want you to, just think of me however you want to think of me. But I ask that question too sometimes. What's really the difference between me and Joe Blow? What really is the difference? They love to give. They're generous. They've got a heart that's kind. They've adopted kids. We've adopted kids. They tithe. They give to charity. We tithe. What's the difference? You see, there is a difference. And I just want to jump back to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. All right, Lord, help us. Help us. Help us. Help us. All right. This is actually Luke 4. I'm just going to start here real quick. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 4. Satan, who is the god of this world, has blinded the minds of those who don't believe. They are unable to see the glorious light of the good news. They don't understand the message about the glory of Christ, who is the exact likeness of God. 2 Corinthians 3, verse 16. But whenever someone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. For the Lord is the Spirit, and wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So all of us who have had the veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. I wrote the question, what's in the margin? What's in the margin? And what I meant by that statement is this. If the margin between the way that I live and the person that I am making Christ appeal to is razor thin, what will I make an appeal to? Those are like magnets that are facing the same direction. The interesting thing about Jesus is that wherever Jesus traveled, people followed. It doesn't say wherever Jesus traveled, people loved him. Some did. It certainly says that wherever Jesus traveled, some hated him. That is true. But wherever Jesus traveled, people were attracted to him. They were curious about him. There was something so dynamically different in the way that he lived, something so incredibly different in the kingdom he represented, that his scripture says that he was making an appeal, the original ambassador, right? He was reconciling men to God. He represented a kingdom so polar opposite that people were like drawn to him like magnets. People were drawn to him like magnets. And so I find this principle at work. The wider the margin that separates your life from that of an unbeliever, the greater the attraction, the greater appeal you will have, the greater substance you will have to draw on as Christ's ambassadors. When I'm talking with Nick about fishing or life or church or his family or whatever, the greater the margin, the more our life looks so totally different. I think about this when I talked about this with Clint and Jackie a while ago. We were talking about kids, and they've done a fantastic job of raising their children so that they're not just talking about the kingdom, but when you look at the way that they live, and you look at the way Clint and Jackie live, and then you look at every one of their kiddos, they're all so in love with Jesus. The margins are so great that when Abby goes to school at a Christian school, it's like, right? There's attraction that happens. When Johnny goes to college at a non-Christian or just a secular university, there's attraction that happens because the margins in their life are like crazy wide. They look nothing like these people. So when they make an appeal out of love, when they're spending time loving others, like the Hebrew writer says, they're not making appeal to a razor-thin margin, a margin that says, man, Jesus loves you. And the other person goes, wow, that's so cool. And what? And what? Well, and if you accept him, you can be everything that you see I am and more. Well, guess what? If you look exactly the same as them, what offering are we making? That's what I'm saying. Better things. Love others. It will keep us from spiritual atrophy. God has in mind for us better things. The gospel is not to be reduced to just the forgiveness of sins, because it is a portion of what Christ has done. I love this clip. Matt, you can play it. I love this clip from The Passion. It's one of my favorites, and I cry every single time because I think it speaks so highly to what Christ was actually doing on the cross. You can go ahead anytime, Matt. Thursday night after men's group, Preston and I and James were taking out the trash and we were getting ready to leave and walked up to the front doors and there was a family out front. I think they were just playing and using the Wi-Fi. It's not uncommon. But as I opened the door, I saw a young man I had met months before. I didn't remember his name, but anyway, he saw me and he came up and I shook his hand and, "Hey man, how are you doing? I am so sorry I forgot your name." "Said, yeah, no problem, my name is Justice. Good to meet you, Justice. Good to see you again." I remember he looked at me and said, "Hey, is there any way I could get $15 for my electric?" That also is not uncommon. I looked at him, he's 22 years old. I don't know a whole lot about his life story, but the moment something just rose up inside of me, and I remember sitting at lunch with Brian Brown as he was talking to me about Tracy's foot and its healing and how it hadn't been going as quickly as they had thought and how it was really discouraging her, like really discouraging her, beyond what would be normal. And he said, "You know what, through this whole process," he said, "it's so interesting, you would think that my focus would have been turned totally inward," he said, "but it hasn't been. The more that I've watched my wife struggle with the healing and with being unable to walk for this time, the more I've watched her mentally have to process through this and wrestle with this, the more I begin to weep every time I see somebody else struggle." It reminded me of the passage in Hebrews where it says this, it says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unacquainted with our suffering. But instead we have one who has in every way been tempted, such as we have, and yet is without sin. So he is able to make a perfect appeal to heaven on our behalf because he's gone through everything that we've gone through. And yet, later in Scripture, it will talk about us being a kingdom of priests to our God." And I mentioned that to Brian. I said, "You know what's so interesting is that Christ went through everything and more that we would ever imagine so that he could perfectly represent us to the Father as high priest. But then he calls us a kingdom of priests." And I think when he makes that declaration over us, what he's saying is, "You also, in your acquaintance with suffering, are being made perfect to relate with this world in two ways: loving others so that we don't result in spiritual atrophy, building tents, making monuments where the presence used to be, right? But in another way too, representing the fullness of his kingdom, not representing a micro slice of some forgiveness and a life that looks like hell. No, fully representing as ambassadors his kingdom in all that it is, in all the fullness thereof, in all the joy, right? In all the peace. The evidence of the gospel is not a lack of suffering. The evidence of the gospel is your attitude in it. He doesn't promise us a suffering-free life, but he promises joy and peace that passes understanding. And if we emulate those things in our lives, we are beginning to widen the margin between us and those that he is making his appeal to through us. And when that margin gets so wide, the poles on those magnets flip and attraction occurs, like Johnny or Adam or any number of them experience when people begin to follow. And so I'm out there thinking all these thoughts and all of a sudden this just comes out of my mouth: "Justice, I won't give you $15, but if you meet me across the street at 7:15 tomorrow morning, I'll take you with me all day." Okay. I'll I'll do that. It's not the first time that I've made an offer like that. Honestly, it's a safe offer to make because most of the time nobody will show. But at 7:15, I drove my truck across the street. I told him, you don't have to worry about missing me. Just look for the big white truck with a big old black trailer. And up comes Justice walking up to the truck. Hops in with me in the back seat and off we go. Dropped him off at Quick Trip at 4:30 that evening. You're not getting $15 to pay your electric, buddy. You get a full day's worth of wages. Thank you for your help. Sent him off to go pay his bill. He looked at me and he said, will your truck be over there on Monday morning? I said, you better believe it. My truck will be there Monday morning. All right. Lord, we pray for justice. We pray for the lost. We pray for those who are in need of Jesus. And we pray for ourselves, too, that you would widen the margins in our life so that we represent the fullness of your kingdom to those who are perishing, so that we would be like the essence of life. We think about that passage in your word that says we long to be swallowed up with life. These bodies that are dying long to be swallowed up with new heavenly bodies that are just filled with life. And we know that as much as we long for that, the world longs to be swallowed up with life. But in order for that to happen, there must be ambassadors. There must be a people who love people. So I ask that you would soften our hearts that we might love your people. I bless this family in the name of Jesus. Will you go out and love the world well this week? We're dismissed. Go buy some baked goods. If anybody needs prayer for any reason, the altars are open. Someone will be here to pray with you. But we're dismissed. I love y'all. I love you guys. Pray for Mondo. He and the family are coming back from vacation in the middle of the week. And, man, if you think about Eddie and Ashley, what you want to speak over them.